Hello everyone, welcome to Smart News Digital, July 18, 2018. So today we are going to see all these topics. So the first topic is BrahMos flight tested in extreme weather conditions. So this is the latest news. So BrahMos is a joint venture between India and Russia. So you see, right, BrahMos means Brahmaputra and Mos means Moscow. So it is BrahMos, which is a joint venture between India and Russia. So the BrahMos is the world's fastest supersonic cruise missile. So supersonic in the sense it has the speed of 3 times more than the speed of the sound, and cruise in the sense it is a guided missile which could be guided from the ground stage. So this BrahMos, which is the supersonic cruise missile, can carry the payloads or the warheads which could go at a faster rate to attack the enemy targets. So this cruise missile has a strike range of around 290 km, and it has main important features like land attack, anti-ship capabilities with multi-role and multi-platform abilities. So first we have to understand the major differences between the cruise missile and the ballistic missile. Cruise missile in the sense it is a guided missile which could be guided from the ground surface or ground stage. So it is used to hit the enemy target which is at a longer distance with higher accuracy. So this cruise missile is subdivided into supersonic, subsonic, hypersonic, etc. depends on the speed in which the missiles are launched. But similarly, if we see the ballistic missiles, it is launched directly into the higher layers of atmosphere with a greater speed, and this ballistic missile follows a parabolic path, and after reaching that higher layers of atmosphere, it is again returned back to the, that means the warhead which is attached to that missile alone detaches itself from the missile and it falls on the enemy's target. So this is how the ballistic missile works. So this is subdivided, that means this ballistic missiles are subdivided into small range ballistic missiles, medium range ballistic missiles, intermediate and intercontinental ballistic missiles. So here recently they tested this cruise missile, which is the supersonic cruise missile BrahMos, in extreme weather conditions, and it worked fine, which means it proved all weather capability. It could work in all the weather conditions, and it is flying in sea state 7. So sea state in the sense it could, how it could withstand the turbulence in the sea. So that is what the sea state refers to, and it ranges from 0 to 9. So 9 is the maximum, but now it could withstand up to 7. So this is proves that how it could withstand the turbulence in the sea and it could attack the enemy target. So the one thing that we should be proud of here is the major subsystems of this BrahMos missile, including the engines or whatever the major things which is present in this cruise missile, are made indigenously under the Make in India campaign. So the second article is activists oppose this draft anti-trafficking bill. So what is the news is the Trafficking of Persons Prevention, Protection and Rehabilitation Bill 2018 is to be planned to be tabled in Parliament during the monsoon session, which is July 18. So if at all this Trafficking of Persons Bill is going to get implemented from the draft stage to the implementation stage, it will criminalize the trafficking which leads to AIDS, begging, as well as the injecting of hormones to the persons involuntarily, which in the sense it actually criminalizes the trafficking. That is the purpose of this Trafficking of Persons Bill 2018. So some people are against this trafficking bill and some people are for this trafficking bill. So if we see who are the persons who are against the bill or what are the reasons, so see here, the activists and the sex workers actually appealed to the Ministry of Women and Child Development that this implementation of this Trafficking of Persons Bill 2018 ultimately lead to the criminalization of the sex workers as well as the transgenders. So if at all you are going to implement this bill, it will obviously lead in future to the criminalization and incarceration, which means the arresting of this sex workers and transgenders in the future. So if a sex worker is getting violated, she couldn't be able to approach the court for justice, and if at all she is going to the court, then she is considered to be exploited, trafficked, and hence she is forced to send for this rehabilitation. So as they are confined to this trafficking or as they are confined to these kind of works, the forceful rehabilitation of those sex workers who are getting affected, if at all we are forcefully rehabilitate them from that work, they obviously going to deprive their main source of livelihood. as they can't go to the court for the justice, these sex workers, maybe in future there could be a possibility of multifold increase in violence against those sex workers. And one more negative point about this trafficking bill, what they proposed is they should be able to differentiate between sex workers and the trafficking. Say, what are the provisions under this trafficking bill? If we see, means those who are involved in this trafficking obviously have to get a trial of 7 to 10 years, and those who are involving in the aggravated form of trafficking could get a trial of 10 years to life imprisonment. So these are the provisions which are included in this anti-trafficking bill if at all a person get caught under this trafficking. So what are those aggravated forms of trafficking? In the sense, trafficking persons for the purpose of forced labor or begging or injecting this chemical substances or hormones for earlier maturity. So all these things could be come under this aggravated form of trafficking. Union Cabinet also recently approved the bill, but it couldn't be able to table the bill before the parliament because of the lot of interruptions or the continuous disruptions whichever happened in the parliament. So in other perspective, if we see this bill is, there are certain people who, especially the survivors of those trafficking, are for this bill or supporting this bill. So they are appealed to this Ministry of Women and Child Development as well as to the activists, stating that this bill should be implemented in order to ensure the safety and security of the women and the children. They also want to ensure the speedy trials of the persons whoever getting involved in this trafficking, and they also want stricter punishment for the traffickers whoever is getting involved in this trafficking and making the children or women or whoever the persons into the forced labor or begging or whatever. So this, if at all this bill gets implemented, the compensation for the victims could also be get availed easily by those victims. So this is one of the major cause why they need, actually why the survivors need this bill to be getting implemented as soon as possible. And this trafficking bill makes rehabilitation of those victims or the rehabilitation of those sex workers as a right of the survivor. So if we make this rehabilitation as a right, then obviously you have to make some provisions in order to ensure that rehabilitation in a better way for those survivors. The next article is, India still lags behind in routine immunization program. So this is what WHO UNICEF report recently states. So if we see the news, in 2017, 19.9 million infants worldwide were not yet reached with the routine services such as 3 doses of diphtheria, tetanus, pertussis vaccine. What they state here is, these much infants are not yet administered with the proper DTP vaccine as of now. So among this 19.9 million infants, around 60% of those children live in 10 major countries, including our country, which is India, Pakistan, as well as in South Africa. Among that 60%, 40% live in very fragile and humanitarian settings. In the sense, they are very vulnerable to the diseases, whatever spreading. So one more major concern is, the global vaccination coverage is still remain the same, like 85% for the last 5 to 10 years, which in the sense, there is no improvement in the number of children who are getting administered with these vaccines despite the increase in the population. So this is one major concern, you understand, right? So meanwhile, it is going, newly available vaccines are also being added, which is the HPV, human papillomavirus. So this vaccine is for treating the viral infection of the reproductive tract, which could obviously causes cervical cancer or other types of cancer for the people. So this vaccine is also not administered properly to the children. So these are all the concerns which is stated by the WHO UNICEF report recently. So one more additional important information is, still 20 million additional children need to be administered with this DTP3 vaccine, and nearly 45 million children need to be administered with this second dose of measles vaccine, and nearly 70 million children are yet to be administered with the third dose of pneumococcal conjugal vaccine. So how they conclude here is, though the universal immunization program have the potential to decrease the number of deaths under the 5 years of age in an effective way, but still more concerted efforts need to be taken by the government to reach this universal immunization coverage in a wider way as well as in a successful way. So the next article is RTI bill to be placed in monsoon session. So what is this RTI Act in the sense? It is a central legislation. It gives access to the public or to the citizens to get the information which are held by the public authority. So you can get any kind of information on how the government functioning or how the political party is functioning. Everything you can get information about all those things by means of this RTI, which is the right to information. So this is to ensure two basic fundamental rights. One is Article 19, which is the freedom of speech and expression. And second one is Article 21, which is right to life and liberty. So this was enacted in 15 June 2005. So what the recent news is, in this Right to Information Amendment Bill to 2018, what the center proposed is, they proposes to give the center the power to set the tenure and the salaries for both the state as well as the central information commissioners. So this is what the major concern for the states, because so at present the tenure of those information commissioners are fixed at 5 years and the salaries are equivalent to the election commissioners. So this is what the present state, but this proposal, that means the center fixing the tenure and the salaries of those information commissioners, again raises the concern among the opposition political parties as well as the RTI activists. They state that constitution, that means this election commission is different from the information commission. Election commission is a constitutional body, whereas the information commission is a statutory body. By considering these facts, you have to make the needs accordingly. So in this slide, they are actually telling why they need this RTI amendment bill and why it is opposed by the RTI activists. So first one is, the center now claims that if at all this RTI amendment bill is going to get implemented, then it is going to ensure the information commissioner's independence. And it also provides a greater grip on the information commissioners by the center. So these are all what the center claims. But what they opposed, or what the opposition parties tells, is if at all this RTI bill is going to get implemented, it will destroy the autonomy of the information commissioners, because the center is now going to control the state and central information commissioners. And it is also fundamentally weaken the institution, which is the RTI Act. So it is going to affect the, or it is going to fundamentally weaken the center and the state information commissions. And it is also going to dilute the federalism, in the sense the center usurping the powers of fixing the tenure and the salaries for the center as well as the state information commissioners may dilute the federalism. And what they conclude here is, this process of amending a law which is actually meant to bring the transparency in our country itself lacking the transparency. So this is how they conclude in this article. So the next article is inflation worries. So recently there is a sharp surge in the wholesale inflation, or the WPI inflation, which shows the inflation of all the commodities, a high of like 5.77 for the first time since May 2014. So it is the highest since like May 2014. This is what the article says. So if you see in this picture, the WPI inflation is like decreasing and it surges again, and it reaches a high of 5.77% this month. That means the last June month. So it is mainly what they tell, the reason is the large contribution for this WPI inflation is mainly because of the fuel prices rises. So though RBI is not using this WPI for its calculation or measurement of these inflation, it is still, the WPI is still a major economically significant factor. So what is the difference between this WPI and CPI? In the sense, WPI represents the basket of wholesale goods, where CPI represents the basket of consumers goods and services, whichever we purchased at the retail shops. So it is a wholesale level, it is a consumer point of view. So WPI covers only the commodities or the goods, but CPI covers both the goods as well as the services. So while calculating this wholesale price index or the WPI, there are certain major constituents. The one is the fuel and the power. The next one is the vegetables and the potatoes, onions, everything. And also the manufactured products, especially this manufactured products only constitute 64.2% of the WPI calculation. So it has the majority weightage. What means this manufactured product? And also, if you see in all these cases, the fuel and the power inflation is hiking from from 4.55 to 16.18%, and the prices of these vegetables and potatoes and onions is also hiking from 2.5 to 8%, and the headline inflation, which is representing the most volatile commodities like food, energy, fuel, everything comes under the headline inflation. Headline inflation in the sense it is more volatile and vulnerable to the inflation or the rise in prices. So that is also increasing from 15.7 to 17%. So this sustained trend of high WPI inflation could add the pressure on the RBI to raise their interest rates in the future, as well as it could potentially undermine our economy's phase of GDP growth.